Hi, it's Carla. Just a heads up for this episode. The subject matter for this episode is the novel Beloved by Toni Morrison and its accompanying film. This means that I will be discussing the history of slavery in America. Accompanying topics will be sexual assault, murder, grief and loss, and racism. If listening to this episode might be too intense for you, I understand, and I will hang out with you next time. Also, this episode is marked as explicit for this reason, so this may not be an episode for young people. Beloved is an adult novel. However, I did read it first at age 17, so this might be a good critical race theory discussion for young people and adult staff together. Finally, I am aware of the serious language issue involving slavery, racism, and this novel. I was very cautious writing this script and left out amazing and illustrative quotes from the novel because I felt that there were some things that I didn't need to read aloud as a respectful white woman. If you are concerned about this, know that you can trust this episode. And now, with all of that, as they say, on with the show. We die. That may be the meaning of life. But we do language. That may be the measure of our lives. Toni Morrison, from her acceptance speech for the Nobel Prize for Literature in 1993. Hi, this is Carla, and welcome back to There Might Be Cupcakes. Happy 50th birthday to me. It was the 16th. That's right, when this podcast started, I was 46. Now I am probably one of the older podcasters, and proud of it. I like being 50. And the 18th was Toni Morrison's birthday. She would have been 91 years old this year. Presidential Medal of Freedom winner, wrote the novel Beloved in 1987. I first and last read it before this Black History Month in the summer of 1989 for Yale Summer School. I attended Yale in high school between 11th and 12th grades and took two classes, Introduction to Psychology and Gender and Political Science. Beloved was one of the required readings for the latter class, and it opened up my entire world. There were some interesting choices for that class, such as the infamous Andrea Dworkin's Intercourse. That's a whole other episode. And a book which I cannot recall that introduced me to how Linda Lovelace was abused on the set of Deep Throat and afterwards. Quite the awakening for this white upper-class kid altogether. Beloved was by far the best on the syllabus. I have the gender and political science syllabus around here somewhere. I'll share it on the podcast when I find it. I think Morrison's novel The Bluest Eye might have been on it as well, but I can't be certain. I really need to find that syllabus. I wonder if Yale's still teaching that particular course. I'm going to have to look. Beloved won the Pulitzer Prize for Fiction in 1998, the year after it was written, as well as the Ansfeld Wolf Book Award, the Robert F. Kennedy Memorial Book Award, the Melcher Book Award, the Lyndhurst Foundation Award, and the Elmer Holmes Bobst Award. It was also a finalist for the National Book Award. This blew my mind after all the wins, so I took a little gander. This was a controversial loss. A novel I had never heard of won. And I read about 150 books a year. Paco's Story by Larry Heinemann. Never heard of him either. How controversial was the win? Larry Heinemann's own publisher thought Beloved had been cheated. Ugh. Quote, "Everybody and their brother thought Toni Morrison was going to win it," said Gerald Howard, executive editor of Penguin, which published the paperback edition of Paco's Story just this week. End quote. Ouch. The other runners-up in 1987 were Alice McDermott's That Night, Howard Norman's The Northern Lights, and Philip Roth's The Counterlife. I've always meant to read Philip Roth. He keeps showing up on my radar. Any recommendations on where to start with him? Let me know on social media or on the subreddit. All of those are in the show notes, of course. The New York Times named Beloved as the top work of American fiction of the last 25 years, from 1981 to 2006. The link from their list, although along with the judges, is in the show notes. It beat out the Rabbit novels by John Updike, which I read in my human development class at Boston University grad school, Blood Meridian by Cormac McCarthy, and American Pastoral by Philip Roth. There he is again. Beloved is part of a loose trilogy, the Beloved Trilogy. To quote Morrison, the conceptual connection is the search for the beloved, the part of the self that is you and loves you and is always there for you. This gels beautifully with one of the last lines of the novel, which I will let you discover for yourself, and also with Sethi, the mother, and Denver, the daughter's particular needs for beloved and how they manifest and are expressed. And in this novel, love is dangerous. In the world of the Fugitive Slave Act, which I will discuss in a moment, when literally the ground under you can be taken from you in a moment's notice, when your family is for sale, love is not safe. So you must search for this lowercase beloved that Morrison describes. The trilogy is Beloved, 1987, Jazz, 1992, and Paradise, 1997. I've not read the other two yet, but will, and we'll be discussing them on the podcast as well. In the midst of writing the trilogy, in 1993, she won the Nobel Prize for Literature. She was the first Black woman from any country to win this prestigious award. How the novel Beloved was conceived is twofold, inspirational and historical. We are blessed in that Morrison shared her creative process with us, considering she was feeling stuck beforehand. I can't discuss the novel without spoiling it, because both the inspirational and historical stories spoil the plot, sort of. Work with me. You know my spoiler policy. Don't listen to an episode without knowing you might be spoiled somewhat, but I won't ever go, how about that ending, huh? Without clearly saying so first. It's all about balance. First, inspirational. Morrison was feeling stymied in her job as an editor, publishing other people's work. So she quit, and she spent time communing with herself at her home, discovering what to write, feeling herself out. Then she had this vision of a young woman in a large hat climbing out of the river behind her house as if born from it, and then winking at her. And that's how she met Beloved. The historical is, of course, more complicated, as is anything dealing with critical race theory and slavery. This entire story, inspirational and historical, is told by Morrison in the edition of Beloved that I reread, the Vintage International Edition. I've linked to it in the show notes. It goes without saying that freedom is a major theme in this novel, but in small as well as grand ways. Sethin, the main character, speaks once about the wonder of waking up in the morning and being able to decide the first thing she's going to do, like wash your face or light the stove. Quote, listening to the doves in Alfred, Georgia, and having neither the right nor the permission to enjoy it, because in that place, mist, doves, sunlight, copper, dirt, moon, everything belonged to the men who had the guns. But this freedom is most important with regards to parenthood. Sethi's mother is only able to have one memorable interaction with her, because she's separated from her and work in the fields from dawn to dusk. Slaves are sold away from their children and their parents. Women are used to breed for their slave owners and so have no ownership of how they choose to be mothers and how their bodies express motherhood. Quote from the introduction. Inevitably, these thoughts led me to the different history of Black women in this country, a history in which marriage was discouraged, impossible, or illegal, in which birthing children was required, but, quote, having them, being responsible for them, being in other words their parent, was as out of the question as freedom. Assertions of parenthood under conditions peculiar to the logic of institutional enslavement were criminal. The idea was riveting, but the canvas overwhelmed me. Summoning characters who could manifest the intellect and the ferocity such logic would provoke proved beyond my imagination, until I remembered one of the books I had published back when I had a job. Morrison is referring to the Black Book, a collection of the, quote, Black experience in America from 1619 through the 1940s. that she compiled and edited for Random House in 1974 of slave auction notices, photos of Black war heroes, information about Black inventors, sheet music from Freedom March chants and work songs and gospel music, all kinds of Black ephemera. A new edition is out now with the original cover, and it's linked in the show notes for purchase. Quoting Morrison, a newspaper clipping in the Black Book summarized the story of Margaret Garner, a young mother who, having escaped slavery, was arrested for killing one of her children and trying to kill the others, rather than let them be returned to the owner's plantation. She became a cause célèbre in the fight against the fugitive slave laws, which mandated the return of escapees to their owners. Her sanity and lack of repentance caught the attention of abolitionists as well as newspapers. She was certainly single-minded, and judging by her comments, she had the intellect, the ferocity, and the willingness to risk everything for what was to her the necessity of freedom. Margaret Garner, known as Peggy, and her family had escaped slavery by crossing the frozen Ohio River from Kentucky to Cincinnati in the winter of 1856 during the Civil War. They were recaptured by U.S. Marshals using the Fugitive Slave Law of 1850. This law was part of the Compromise of 1850, led by Senator Henry Clay and Senator Stephen A. Douglas under President Millard Fillmore, after the debate over slavery in the American territories that had started during the Mexican-American War. Southerners wanted to expand slavery laws to the newly won territories from this war, and Northerners did not. That's the simple, cut-and-dried version. Several bills were introduced under the Compromise that aren't that important here. But two that are the fact that each territory got to decide if it allowed slavery, and a much stricter fugitive slave law was introduced, superseding that act of 1793. Now, all federal officials in all American states and territories, including those that did not allow slavery, were required by law to help with the return of slaves that had escaped to their former masters under a penalty of a huge fine. All law enforcement had to arrest anyone suspected of being a runaway slave based only on someone's testimony of ownership. Think about that. Someone white steps forward and says, "I own that person." And law enforcement is compelled to arrest them. Period. That's terrifying. Yeah, so basically any white person could claim they owned any Black person under oath. And law enforcement would be compelled, like I said, to arrest on word alone. Any officer that captured a runaway slave was rewarded with a fee paid by the federal government. So there was a government bounty. People suspected to be runaway slaves were not entitled to jury trials, nor to testify under oath on their own behalf. The judges were paid $5 for finding a person to be free, but $10 for finding them to be an escaped slave, so there was a reward built into the system. Helping a runaway slave by providing any aid whatsoever was now a federal crime, punished by $1,000 back then, and at least 6 months in prison. Sorry, I just have to sit with all that for a minute. Quoting the introduction to Beloved, I wanted the reader to be kidnapped, thrown ruthlessly into an alien environment as the first step into a shared experience with the book's population, just as the characters were snatched from one place to another, from any place to any other, without preparation or defense. Margaret Garner was born as a house slave at Maplewood Plantation, Boone County, Kentucky. The slave owners were the Gaines family. She married a fellow slave, Robert Garner, in 1849. According to Wikipedia, her children, two boys, a 6-year-old named Thomas, a 4-year-old, a 2.5-year-old named Mary, and Priscilla the infant, were suspected to be fathered by her slave owner, by the abolitionist Levi Coffin. On January 28, 1856, 17 people in total fled across the frozen Ohio River, including all of Margaret's family members and Margaret, who was then pregnant. Levi Coffin helped the family split up. Some made it to Canada via the Underground Railroad. Margaret, Robert, and their children were sent to her uncle Joe Kite's house in Cincinnati. Coffin went for help to assure a safe house, and before he could return to Joe Kite's house, U.S. Marshals found him. Seeing the Marshals, Margaret killed Mary and wounded the other children, trying to kill them and herself, rather than have them all return to slavery, before the posse was able to break into the house and stop her. The trial lasted for weeks because the judge could not decide whether to try the Garners as property under the Fugitive Act or to try them as people for the murder of Mary. The judge finally ruled for property. On the closing day, the abolitionist Lucy Stone took the stand to defend herself for speaking with Margaret because the prosecutor had complained to the court. Quote from Lucy, "Rather than give her daughter to that life, she killed it. If in her deep maternal love she felt the impulse to send her child back to God, to save it for coming woe, who shall say she had no right not to do so?" The court decided to also try her for murder, but her slave owners would not give up their property that easily. This is harder to read than I expected it to be. And moved her and Robert from house to house, hiding them from the law. On March 6, 1856, the family was on a steamboat being moved to yet another plantation when that boat wrecked with another steamboat. Margaret and her infant were thrown overboard and the child drowned. Margaret reportedly exclaimed that she was happy that her second child died and tried to drown herself. In 1870, the Cincinnati Chronicle located Robert Garner. In 1857, Robert and Margaret had been sold to another family of slave owners in Tennessee, Landing, Mississippi. Margaret had died the next year of typhoid. Robert told the newspaper that she'd made him promise to, quote, never marry again in slavery, but to live in hope of freedom. All this death, the death of children to save them from worse, leads us to the heart of the novel Margaret inspired, and ghosts. To quote from Morrison's introduction, "The terrain, slavery, was formidable and pathless. To invite readers and myself into the repellent landscape, hidden but not completely, deliberately buried but not forgotten, was to pitch a tent in a cemetery inhabited by highly vocal ghosts." And finally, quote, "In trying to make the slave experience intimate, I hoped the sense of things being both under control and out of control would be persuasive throughout, that the order and quietude of everyday life would be violently disrupted by the chaos of the needy dead, that the Herculean effort to forget would be threatened by memory desperate to stay alive. To render enslavement as a personal experience, language must get out of the way." Which brings me to the novel's intriguing epigraph. It's from the book of Romans in the Bible's New Testament, Romans 9:25. Quote, "I will call them my people, which were not my people, and her beloved, which was not beloved." It's so interesting to me because it's evocative of the story of Ruth in the Old Testament as she begs to stay with her mother-in-law, Naomi. It's Ruth 1:16. I'll read Ruth 1:15 through 17 for content. This is the New International Version translation. "Look," said Naomi, "your sister-in-law has gone back to her people and her gods. Follow her back home." But Ruth replied, "Do not urge me to leave you or turn from following you. For wherever you go, I will go, and where you live, I will live. Your people will be my people, and your God will be my God. Where you die, I will die, and there I will be buried. May the Lord punish me and ever so severely if anything but death separates you and me." Same resonance, but not. Because pay attention to the negatives in the Roman passage. "I will call her beloved, which was not beloved." Interestingly dark, given that we are entering a story of slavery and murder and grief and a ghost. Think back to that negative as you read the novel and watch the film, as beloved becomes as the baby ghost grows into her power and expresses her feelings. Remember that not. The full verse makes a callback to the Old Testament book of Hosea, starting, "as he says in Hosea." That precise callback is Hosea 2:23, which is, "and I will sow her as my own in the land, and I will have compassion on," quote, "no compassion. I will say to those called, quote, not my people, you are my people, and they will say, you are my God. This has fascinating implications for the role plants play in this novel, but also is reading this verse as a deliverance verse, deliverance from slavery. Revisiting this novel, I discovered it lush with plants. Corn husks and silks around Sethi and her man as they make love to consummate their marriage on the plantation's sweet home. Sethi's daughter Denver's emerald castle of shrubbery that she retreats to as a place of safety and self-discovery. Lily of the valley perfume. Chamomile sticking to Sethi's bare legs and feet when she returns to the house and sees Paul D for the first time since sweet home. Plants and flowers and crops are everywhere, and they inform choices and invoke memories and create both safe spaces and dangerous ones. First, the plantation. Quote, there was sweet home rolling, rolling, rolling out before her eyes. And although there was not a leaf on that farm that did not make her want to scream, it rolled itself out before her in shameless beauty. It never looked so terrible as it was, and it made her wonder if hell was a pretty place too. Fire and brimstone all right, but hidden in lacy groves. Then the haunted 124 Bluestone Road. Quote, out of the dimness of the room in which they sat, a white staircase climbed towards the blue and white wallpaper of the second floor. Paul D. could see just the beginning of the paper, discreet flecks of yellow sprinkled among a blizzard of snowdrops, all backed by blue. The luminous white of the railing and steps kept him glancing towards it. Every sense he had told him the air above the stairwell was charmed and very thin. Then Denver's hidey hole. Denver, one of Sethi's daughters, loves the high hedges behind 124 that grow together in a natural house taller than any man. And it's her private place, away from the ghost, away from the family, away from white people. Quote, veiled and protected by the live green walls, she felt ripe and clear, and salvation was as easy as a wish. Her, quote, emerald closet standing 7 feet high in the woods reminded me of a song, Kate Bush's Under the Ivy. The reference to the party even makes sense once you read the novel. Quote, it wouldn't take me long to tell you how to find it, to tell you where we'd meet. The little girl inside me is retreating to her favorite place. Go into the garden, go under the ivy, under the leaves, away from the party. I sit here in the thunder, the green on the gray. I feel it all around me, and it's not easy for me to give away a secret. It's not safe. Beloved is described as a shiny plant coming forth. Quote, women did what strawberry plants did before they shot out their thin vines. The quality of the green changed. Then the vine threads came, then the buds. By the time the white petals died and the mint-colored berry poked out, the leaf shine was gilded tight and waxy. That's how Beloved looked, gilded and shining. Finally, plants along the river are described as hope. Quote, spores of blue fern growing in the hollows along the riverbank float towards the water in silver-blue lines, hard to see unless you are in or near them, lying right at the river's edge where the sun shots are low and drained. Often they are mistook for insects, but they are seeds in which the whole generation sleeps confident of a future. And for a moment it is easy to believe each one has one. Will become all of what is contained in the spore, will live out its days as planned. This moment of certainty lasts no longer than that, longer perhaps than the spore itself. This novel teems with plant life. Once I saw it, it couldn't go unseen. It was like ivy was reaching out of the pages at me, like I could smell frying okra. Oh my God, how I miss my great-grandma's fried okra. And the dying roses on the way to the carnival, and my legs itch from the weeds and the corn stalks susurrated, and then we turn to a haunted house. A house haunted by grief and by a baby that didn't get to be and comes back. Quote, shivering, Denver approaches the house, regarding it, as she always did, as a person rather than a structure, a person that wept, sighed, trembled, and fell into fits. Her steps and her gaze were the cautious ones of a child approaching a nervous, idle relative, someone dependent but proud. Thinking and reading about 124, and Denver's experience in it in particular, brought to mind a song I love. sorry to say, I'm not a Kate Bush fan in particular. It's Taylor Swift 7 from her album Folklore. Quote, "Sweet tea in the summer, cross your heart, won't tell no other. And though I can't recall your face, I've still got love for you. Your braids like a pattern, love you to the moon and Saturn. Passed down like folk songs, this love lasts so long. And I've been meaning to tell you, I think your house is haunted. And I think you should come live with me, and we can be pirates. Then you won't have to cry or hide in the closet. And just like a folk song, our love will be passed on. Please picture me in the weeds before I learned civility. I used to scream ferociously anytime I wanted. I. When you read the book and or see the film, you'll realize the multiple voices I hear in this edited version of the song. I've linked both songs in the show notes so you can hear them. This novel will make you question exactly what a ghost is, what a haunting is, the many ways a house can be haunted. It made me want to read more about African American folklore. I read a lot about it as that strange kid in elementary school that was allowed to roam the library during class. I've talked about that on the podcast. My small rural school had some unusual nonfiction books. I vaguely remember reading about this subject and about the Hound of Goshen, about hoodoo and African American gospel. It's all of a hodgepodge the way memory can be. I want to do some proper research now. A horror movie along this vein that I highly recommend is 2020 Spell, directed by Mark Tondere. It stars almost 100% black cast, and the main two players are Omari Hardwick and Loretta Devine in what I think is her best role. As I said in my Letterboxd review, quote, "An almost entirely black cast explores the racial politics within the black community through the lens of hoodoo. Beautifully done and terrifying. It as well explores manhood as a theme, as Beloved does. Beloved has manhood as a strong and powerful theme. The five men waiting for Sethi to choose one of them after she first arrives at the Sweet Home Plantation. The master insisting his slaves were men, not boys, to them and to other slave owners. Paul D. shouting down the ghost at 124, and Denver being afraid he'd driven it away. And this lovely description of Paul D., quote, "Not even trying, he had become the kind of man who could walk into a house and make the women cry. Because with him in his presence, they could. There was something blessed in his manner. Women saw him and wanted to weep, to tell him that their chest hurt and that their knees did too. Strong women and wise saw him and told him things they only told each other." The novel was filmed in 1998 by Jonathan Demme, the director of Silence of the Lambs. It starred Oprah Winfrey as Sethi, Danny Glover as Paul D., her friend on the plantation and her lover in present time, Thandi Newton as Beloved, and Kimberly Elise as Denver. Bea Richards from Drugstore Cowboy, Roots, The Heat of the Night, and The Miracle Worker played Baby Suggs. And if her speech about loving your body doesn't make you weak, watch it again. I watched the film on February 10th for the first time in what can only be described as an emotional stupor. It made me physically soggy and weak, like an Errol Stanlos flare-up. My Letterboxd review was written immediately afterwards and was so short because I was so stunned. Quote, "The most brutal scenes of the novel were not filmed, and this is still one of the most haunting and disturbing films I've ever seen." And they weren't. They were important slavery scenes, pivotal ones, that I wonder if studio interference kept Demme from filming. Scenes from the novel that are seared into my brain and are crucial to explaining why a woman would kill one child and try to kill the others when the slave catchers showed up. One particular and shocking pregnancy-related sexual assault scene is shown, but truncated in a really odd way, shown seconds at a time. Sethi describes it to Paul D. It goes on for pages in the novel, as frankly I think it should. It's absolutely central to Sethi's pain and torment. It is her never again, her reason for protecting her children in the horrific manner she did, especially for protecting her daughters. And yet, this is a gorgeous and horrible film, in the original sense of the word horrible. It is not horror adjacent, it is horror. Just as I believe this is a horror novel. The genres listed on Letterboxd pulled from the Internet Movie Database are drama and thriller, to which I plainly call bullshit. Fandy Newton is haunting in every sense of the word as the character Beloved. I couldn't stop watching the things she did with her body and her jaw and her mouth and her voice. It's otherworldly, uncanny. It's like she isn't quite human. She truly seems like an infant at times. In a lovely irony, her full first name, Thandoe, means beloved. The film's tagline is beautifully succinct. The past has a life of its own. Speaking of which, time is extremely fluid in this novel. I found several times that I wasn't immediately certain when I was. Sethi's arrival at 124 with baby Suggs and her children, now at 124 with Paul D, Beloved, Denver, and Sethi, at Sweet Home, but when exactly at Sweet Home? The novel is fluid the way memory and dreams are both fluid. I advise you to roll with it, flow with it, get into the flow state of reading. Once I stopped being an intellectual about it, and let myself just be snatched from one place to the other, just as Morrison said she intended, I got it, and it got me. Margaret Garner also inspired a work of art, Thomas Satterwhite's painting The Modern Medea. It's the image for this episode, and I'll share a full version of it on the website entry for this episode. In Greek mythology, Medea helped Jason get the Golden Fleece, after which he abandoned her, and in revenge, she killed their children. It's not an accurate analogy, in my opinion, unless you just look at Medea as a desperate and enraged mother. By the by, this movie is considered folk horror. It was briefly included in the new documentary Woodlands Dark and Days Bewitched, A History of Folk Horror, which I highly recommend, and which I will probably do a deep dive on in a later episode once I've done some reading. I cloned somebody else's list of every film included in the documentary. You can check my Letterboxd profile for it if you're interested, and that's linked in the show notes. And please feel free to follow me there, and I'll follow you back. I have a list on my profile of every film I mentioned in the podcast with a link back to the episode that it's mentioned in. I highly recommend listening to the audiobook for Beloved. It's narrated by Toni Morrison herself, and her voice, oh, her voice feels like the archetypical mother voice, capital M. It's so soothing and comforting that it makes me want to cry. Remember, if you use the Audible link in the show notes, you get a free month of Audible to try it out. And if you choose Beloved or any one of the 11 books she narrated, you keep your choice for free even if you cancel. I've linked all of them in the show notes. Trust me, she's one of the most soothing and thralling audiobook narrators ever. And you can take that coming from me. I've been a member of Audible since 2000. That's 22 years of listening, so no hyperbole. Another one of Morrison's novels, in which she uses the motif of motherhood and daughterhood to explore slavery, and vice versa, is A Mercy, in which a mother sends away her daughter in order to save her. And that daughter plays dangerous games trying to fill that mother-shaped hole in 1680s Maryland. Its language is just as darkly and devastatingly poetic. Quote, I am making me quiet, but I am loose inside, not knowing how to be. It's also one of her novels that Morrison narrated, and it's linked in the show notes. Given Morrison's theme of the Beloved trilogy, finding love within yourself, I leave you with an apt and beautiful quote from the novel that does not spoil the ending. I hope you've enjoyed this exploration into a gorgeous novel and film about the darkest period of American history. I spent a couple of weeks sitting with how to address it. How to address the political without making the episode grossly political and preachy. And how to manage my language and remember the entire time that I am a white woman. And that even though I live on government funds and am disabled, I am still privileged. And I had to watch my language and my thought processes like no other episode except the one where I told my own sexual assault story, which, if curious, is episode 34. And the truth is, America was built upon the forced labor and stolen lives of other people. And part of Black History Month is acknowledging all of the inventors, scientists, writers, musicians, creators, and otherwise beautiful people that were wasted, broken, and killed by slavery. and that's horror. Let the beautiful mind of Toni Morrison teach you about it, about the little triumphs, embraces, and laughters and loves. There was still love despite the abject cruelty. Quote, "She is a friend of my mind. She gathers me, man. The pieces I am, she gather them and give them back to me in all the right order. It's good, you know, when you got a woman who is a friend of your mind." I hope you have a friend of your mind. I do, and I know he's listening. The point of learning our history is not to shame ourselves and each other, but to honor our journey and each other's, and to never repeat the cruelty. One thing I've learned from Beloved is we need to be our own best thing. I hope I have done this haunting, gorgeous novel and this haunting, horrible, crucial subject justice. If I have fallen short, please know that it was approached with love, and please know you can contact me via any method in the show notes, including privately via email at carla@theremightbecupcakes.com, and I will humbly and gratefully listen. Trust me, I worried about every detail, including whether or not it was okay to use the song lyrics of two white women in this episode, no matter how apropos. I have worried. But I decided to get out of my own way and to express myself. As I quoted Morrison at the beginning, we do language that may be the measure of our lives. You can always contact me and talk about the podcast, no matter the episode. This podcast will always be a loving dialogue about books and language and human nature, because I love you guys. Hi, it's me again. I'm popping back in to introduce the outro music, because I'm afraid if I just let it play, it'll be seen as a joke. Since this song has been used over the years as a joke in both cartoons and in movies such as Ferris Bueller's Day Off, I'm using the spiritual with great respect to its anti-slavery and civil rights message and to its singer, the renowned Marian Anderson. I have this recording thanks to the Library of Congress. It's pressed on 78 record and then uploaded digitally. It was recorded on May 29, 1924. Marian Anderson was an amazing black contralto soloist. In 1939, the organization DAR, the Daughters of the American Revolution, blocked her from performing in front of an integrated audience in Washington, D.C.'s prestigious Constitution Hall. The First Lady, Eleanor Roosevelt, was personally offended and got President Franklin Roosevelt involved. With their backing, Anderson sang an open-air concert on April 9th, Easter Sunday of that year, on the steps of D.C.'s Lincoln Memorial, standing before President Abraham Lincoln's statue, singing for an integrated crowd of over 75,000 people and for the national radio. Almost 20 years later, on January 7, 1955, Anderson was the first African American to sing at the Metropolitan Opera, again for an integrated audience. She, like Toni Morrison, won the Presidential Medal of Freedom. The link to this hauntingly lovely piece of American history is in the show notes.
My people are a legends and lore, monsters and myths, hauntings and horror. Best-selling authors Tamara Thorne and Alistair Cross are digging deep in their research files to bring you face-to-face with the unknown, the unusual, the bizarre. Come one, come all, step right up and take a walk on the dark side at Thorne and Cross Carnival Macabre. Coming soon.